Welcome to Someone Talked, the official podcast of the National D-Day Memorial, where leading experts spill all the secrets of the Second World War, with your host, Dr. John C. McManus.
Greetings. Welcome to Someone Talked. I'm your host, Dr. John C. McManus, Curator's Distinguished Professor of U.S. Military History at Missouri S&T. And alongside, as always, are my dear friends from the National D-Day Memorial Foundation, April Cheek Messier, John Long, and Angela Lynch. How are my partners in crime today?
Fantastic. Happy to be here.
We are doing well.
Good to be here.
Absolutely. We always love doing this, but man, what a special guest we have today. Someone who has served this country on so many levels for so long. Major General Mary Kay Eder served the United States Army for 36 years. She branched as a signals officer in 1977. Just a little bit of background on some of the big jobs she's had in the Army. She was Deputy Chief of the United States Army Reserve, Deputy Chief of the United States Army Public Affairs. She was Commanding General of the United States Army Reserve Joint and Special Troops Support Command, which is later on going to be the 76th Operational Reserve Command. She's just really been there and done that in the Army for a long period of time. And as if that's not enough, of course, now she's an author, too. So she's written a fascinating book that's, sort of the focus of our discussion today, called The Girls Who Stepped Out of Line. And the general format of the book is individual stories of women, not just American women, but of women in World War II, and all the various experiences that they had, many of them really kind of front and center combat experiences or espionage experiences, some in a support job, whatever it would be. And one of the many fascinating things about the book is you really get to know each individual. And so Mary has really a talent for bringing each person to life and of course, backing a lot of this up with excellent scholarship. So, you served for 36 years. You've sort of lived this life too on many levels, a different generation of course too, but how does that get you to this point where you're looking at these specific individuals? How'd you choose these folks? How maybe was this informed by your own military experiences? Where did it all come from, do you think?
Well, I'll tell you that my early days in the Army Reserve in the 1980s, and this is in Virginia in the 80th Training Division, a lot of our equipment said 1944 on it. and some of the training was still reminiscent of those days. We still were digging foxholes in the woods. And, just before talking about airland battle and some of the changes coming into the Army then. So there was already the connection there. And there was this history of the division I was in that I had to learn, of course. And so I felt the connection already. And in some of these stories, as I came to them, so I would read a little bit about, for example, Kate Flynn, who was a nurse. And when I had read about her story, it said, and then the nurses put up the tent. Sometimes you can tell when people who are not military, don't have a background, write something, they get the details a little bit wrong. Putting up a GP medium tent is not easy. And I cannot imagine 18 nurses doing this, moving every 10 days as their hospital follows armor and infantry units, putting up the tents first for triage and then for surgery. And they had to get good at it, but it wasn't something that's easy or was done quickly. And so part of my motivation in finding some of these stories was I wanted to do right by them and get their stories right. I talked a little bit about Stephanie Czech, who worked with the OSS and was undercover in Poland at the end of the war. And what part of her story said, and it was a dangerous place, the naval attaché disappeared. Well, no. I read the story by the ambassador, U.S. ambassador to Poland, and the naval attaché had wandered onto a bridge in the fog and fallen off. He didn't disappear. They knew who it was. They returned the body to his family. So some of the things that were legends or just made up that went along with some of these stories, I wanted to fix, I wanted to change it, and I wanted to do right by the people who I had found.
Well, you certainly did, Mary Kay. And I'm still battling a little bit of laryngitis here on this episode, but I just have to tell you how much it meant to have you with us recently on Veterans Day. And the lines of people to get your book was just incredible. And I think it just speaks to the fact that people really love these stories. They want to hear these stories. They want to know these women, their backgrounds, and what led them to do what they did. So thank you for bringing that to us in this incredible book. And one of my favorites in the book was the story of Mary Siglio Baracco, who I dearly love. She was one of our speakers at the memorial some years ago, and I'll never forget her because she came to us, you know, so meek and mild and quiet. And then she went up to the podium, and when she spoke, it was like a lion, you know, she just came to life. And everything she said was so, it resonated with people, and it was so relevant to even today, even now, when we think about our history and why it's important that we remember these things and how easily it can all happen again. So an incredible story about Mary. Can you share a little bit of her story with our listeners and why her story was important to you to include?
About the nurse?
Mary Siglio Baracco.
Oh, about Mary.
Yes, about Mary. Dame Mary. She was incredible.
She was incredible. And she was incredible because she would not be silenced.
Right.
Even when she was being held in prison after she had been pistol whipped to the point where she had medical issues for the rest of her life, her back broken, she'd been sterilized, and she hears a plane overhead and she knows it's an American plane, and she starts to call out, "Viva the Americans." Hmm. So she would never be silenced, and all of her speaking was, as you said, to talk about the importance of freedom. You never know, you will miss your freedom until you have it taken away from you. She spoke to military groups. She spoke to a group of non-commissioned officers, Army non-commissioned officers, and then supported the NCO group in scholarships for their children for years after that. She was always involved with the military and living in the Virginia Beach area and with the Navy, with the Army, with the Air Force. And I have pictures of her riding in, I think it was a Memorial Day parade. She was very well known in that area for all that she did and for all that she did to promote an understanding of the importance of freedom. There's a college that did a play about her life, and she had seen this play and was, of course, amazed by it. But it's important that we keep telling her story because I don't want her to ever be forgotten.
That's right. And I think it's important to point out that she was just a teenager when she joined the resistance. So she was an American teenager at the time.
She was. And you know, people say, how could she have done that? Well, I think for most of the women I wrote about, and for most people, really, you take one step, you take a small risk. We're not like the Nazis. We're going to let the air out of their bicycle tires. Ha, ha, ha. And then that changes to a little bit more and a little bit more until they're very deeply involved in doing things that are quite dangerous. And it was a member of their group who turned her in, along with her fiance.
That's right. And I believe he was later executed.
It was executed. So, yeah. And they made a point of telling her while she was in prison.
That's right.
So I was able to see some of her notebooks that she had saved. In that prison, there were nuns, and the nuns actually helped feed her, take care of her, give her first aid after some of the beatings. And she went in later years back to Belgium to visit those nuns. And that's in some of her scrapbooks and her notebooks on visiting them, going back to say thank you.
Well, General, World War II obviously brought to the forefront the idea of women serving in the military in all branches. And women had worn the uniform before World War II, but this is the war that really set the bar so much higher. So as an Army veteran, tell us why you think the Women's Army Corps deserves our thanks and our admiration, and describe the jobs that the Women's Army Corps did.
Well, if you're familiar with the expression, building the airplane while you're flying it, that's pretty much how the Women's Army Corps started. for those who worked in the basic training companies, whether they were at somewhere at Fort Lee, there was one in Georgia and the other one in Fort Des Moines, Iowa, there were no regulations when they started. There was no plan. There was no course syllabus for what we're going to teach young women as they come in. What are we going to teach them in basic training? And they were writing the plans while they were actually executing them. So they're changing constantly. So they're churning out people from one course to the next that might be a little bit different in things they'd learned. They all got the basics, how to march, yes, sir, no, ma'am. They had to do physical training. Even the WASP, the young women who joined the WASP were told they would be commissioned as lieutenants in the Army Air Corps. But then that didn't happen, and they were civilians. They were government civilians at a GS, low-level GS grade. But they still had to march, wear a uniform, learn all about making flight plans, and then do everything else necessary to earn their wings. And they were taught by Army Air Corps pilots, men. Some of them didn't want to be there. Some of them didn't agree with having women fly. But they got all of the same instruction, and when they earned those wings, they kept them, the silver wings.
So they, you know, in the case of the ground troops, the Women's Army Corps, I mean, they're going to serve in every corner of the globe, including New Guinea, where they're initially going to be deployed in skirts, and I have to kind of fight to get, you know, uniformed like everybody else appropriately. And then later on in the Philippines, you have some, of course, in Italy, in Britain. You know, the purpose of it all, according to the War Department of the time, is to free up men for combat and women doing other jobs like administrative, clerical, which was happening a lot on the home front, too. But there's also a kind of an intel side to this. There's a cryptanalysis side to it. And then there are mechanics, too. I wonder if you could elaborate a little bit about that.
And photographers. There were also photographers who did the battle damage assessments being assigned to the air wings in Britain. So they processed all of the film from the bombers. And they also took some pictures themselves. It was one of the stories that I wasn't able to include in the book was about one of these photographers who was able to get into the photography piece or public affairs in the Women's Army Corps because she had a camera. Not many people had cameras. So if I'm going to join, I'm going to get to use my camera. And so they finally agreed and put her into the branch with the Army Air Corps so she could work in the darkroom there. So I think that overall, there are many jobs that women had. There was the driver for General Eisenhower. So there were some drivers. Now the COMZ, the communication zone behind the front lines, was in Britain. And so that's where you had a number of these positions, including all of the women who were in the 6888, the only all women, all African American women unit to be deployed overseas in World War II. They were in Birmingham, and their job was to fix the mail. There had been no mail delivered, or very little, for the past 2 years because of the pace of operations on the continent. So when she arrived with her unit in February 1945, and they got to where the mail had been stored, there were 17 million pieces of mail stacked up there. Old Christmas packages with food in them, rotten things rotting. They had over 7,000 pieces of mail that were addressed simply to Junior. You know, people were naive about how to send the mail or, well, it's from me, they'll find him. And so they had quite a bit of work to do. So there were 855 women in this unit. Their commander, Charity Adams, divided them up into three groups, three shifts, and they each shift processed 56,000 pieces of mail until they worked their way through. They were given 6 months to do this mission. And by the way, others had tried it and failed, and they did it in three. So what happens in the Army when you do well at something? You get more to do. So they end up in Rouen, France, where they processed all of the diplomatic mail that had been held up.
Yeah. So, all right. I want to explore this with you some more. Because I mean, most of the women we've talked about are white women, and at least would have had that advantage in a sense, even as they were not necessarily always treated as equals by men. In the case of Charity Adams and the 6888, they're African American. So on top of it, you have these layers of segregation, and then you have this remarkable leader in Adams. I mean, that of course 6888 is pretty famous now, and there's going to be a new movie coming out on Netflix that Tyler Perry is the main guy behind and all this, and it should just be great. But I think that when we talk about great leadership, I think that Charity Adams is someone who could teach us a lot. I really enjoyed that element of your chapter. So she deals with a lot of these issues we were talking about, issues of opportunity, issues of challenges, certainly the missing challenges, you've outlined it, but also sort of racial and gender issues too, even while in England.
She does. And I'll tell you, she never backed down. When I talked to her son, one of the things he's told me was, she was always the best prepared person in the room. She would read everything. And even in later in life, when she was on the board for the American Red Cross, they would be in meetings and talk about passing their new bylaws. And she would say, no, on page 274, paragraph CA, there is this. So she was that well prepared for everything she did. She knew fully well all of the regulations on there will be no discrimination in certain things. When a general came to visit her unit, because once they got going, lots of people came to visit, as happens, and then all of the senior people want to come and see what you're doing. And he was angry because she didn't have all of her soldiers in formation. And she said, well, some are sleeping, some are working, and some are off. And he said, that's not acceptable. Do I need to send in a white lieutenant to teach you how to do this? And she said, over my dead body. And then a little later, she realized, well, maybe that wasn't a great idea. So she's planning on what to do about this in case there is a problem. That general later regretted his remarks and came and apologized to her by the time they were in France. It's not that they became friends, but that there was a mutual sense of respect after that.
I wonder who that general was. I was so intrigued by that.
I have her autobiography. And I learned quite a bit from it, too. I don't recall if the name is in there or not, but I'll go back and look. I don't think it is.
Yeah, I doubt it.
Now, I have her autobiography because I started to write this book at the beginning of the pandemic. So I signed the contract to finish it on January 30th of 2020. In February, everything shuts down. My deadline is May 1st, and I'd written nothing. So I started buying books online. Many of them have in the book, and it's true in her autobiography, there's a little slip cover in the front that says property of the Sioux City, Iowa Library. So, but I have a great collection now, because many wrote books, even if just for their families. They wrote them after the war. And I learned quite a bit about her preparation for this job, because she taught herself. She too was at Fort Des Moines, where Stephanie Check was, working in basic training. And she too was bored with it. So she took on other things to teach herself how to be ready for greater challenges. She traveled with the WAC band. She did war bonds. She learned how to run a dining facility. She worked in doing military justice. So she would understand how all of this came together as a commander. She got herself ready. And I wouldn't have known that if I hadn't read her autobiography.
I mean, it's just a remarkable and effective leader. So you think the key to her leadership success is preparation. Are there any other intangibles, though, that maybe went along with that, in your opinion?
She had a very strong moral core at her center, and she would not tolerate injustice. Now, there was the Red Cross had put up a hotel near where they were in Birmingham, and we would like to encourage your soldiers to go there. It was segregated. And she said, none of them will go, because it wasn't supposed to work that way. And so she made absolutely sure nobody did. All of her soldiers knew that she had their backs and that she would take care of them.
Well, and the classic example of that is when she stands up to that general. because if, as you know better than anybody, if she uproots everything to have them out in formation against what they really ought to be doing and probably away from taking time away from what they're supposed to be there to do, that's going to be a serious dent in morale and probably, estimation of her leadership, I would expect.
Right. And she also knew that that to have that formation was for his ego and for no other purpose.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Now, at the end of the war, she's given a promotion to lieutenant colonel. And she went from second lieutenant to lieutenant colonel in 4 years. I'm a little jealous of that. and she was offered a position in the Pentagon. And she said, I've been to the Pentagon. I got lost. I didn't like it. So she elects to leave service and go back to school and finish her degree. She was going to college at Ohio State to finish her master's and then doctorate. But you mentioned there's another unit that I just want to mention that was a segregated unit. And this is part of the code breakers. At Arlington Hall Station, where the Army had its code breakers, there was an African-American women's section, but they had a different mission, too. Their job was to look at American business to see who was cooperating with the Nazis. I haven't been able to find too much more about them in depth, but it was a very different mission.
What was that unit, I wonder?
I don't know the name of the unit. It was part of the Arlington Hall Station effort.
General, we've previously had Kate Landeck on our program, historian of WASP veterans. And so hopefully our listeners are familiar with their service breaking new ground, flying over it. Do you have any favorites among the WASP?
Well, I wrote about Millie Rexroth, who was the only Native American woman to serve with the WASP. And she came to it rather late. She came in the summer of 1944. So by the time she graduated, the WASP were only in existence a few months after that. So the dream isn't the same for everyone. I mean, she achieved the dream. She got to become a pilot. She earned her silver wings. And then she worked in towing targets for ground and air gunners. But she didn't get to do it for long before the program ended. And she never flew again.
Wow.
At the time, it was said that, well, the public would not put up with having women pilots. So she became an air traffic controller, transferred later into the Air Force Reserve, and stayed through Korea. But she was one of my favorites because she continued, even though she couldn't have the original dream she started with. Now, the WASP program is just an incredible story in and of itself with all of those who served. And, of course, later, I think it's in 2008, they earned the Congressional Gold Medal. Now, there have only been 400 of those Congressional Gold Medals presented since the very first one, which was given to George Washington. And I was privileged to be on Capitol Hill last year in February when the gold medal was voted for the 6888. It hasn't been presented yet. It's still being minted. There might be a few supply chain issues with that.
When is there not?
So, Mary Kay, a few years ago, we were very privileged to welcome to the memorial one of the Code Girls. We had Dorothy Braden Bruce with us.
Yes.
She was incredible, a spitfire, to say the least. But for years, again, she said nothing about her service, you know, breaking codes, thinking it was all still classified. And as you know, in only recent years, is that story finally kind of being told now. Can you talk about the role of women in signals intelligence, such as in your book with Betty Robarts?
Well, Betty joined the Navy because Betty was a championship swimmer in college. And of course, now there's no opportunity for her to continue. There's not going to be an Olympics in 1940, not going to be one in 1944. So she said, I was tired of swimming and I was tired of college. She tried to join the Army, but she wasn't old enough. So her dad had to sign for her to join the Navy. And she did end up at the Nebraska Avenue complex where. And she was enlisted. She was not an officer. And so they vetted her and put her into the program to help build the bomb machine. So she was sure she was going west, like maybe to the West Coast with beaches and sunshine. Well, west meant sugar camp, which was in Dayton, Ohio, where the National Cash Register Company had their training facility, which was little, like a whole campus of little huts. And in Hut 16 is where the bomb machine was built. So Betty spent the war, along with about 600 other waves, building this massive computer. But she never saw it. She never saw a finished one. And it wasn't until the mid-1990s that they had a reunion in Sugar Camp for all of those who'd served, and about 300 of them went. And they were told that what they had done helped end the war 1 to 2 years earlier than it would have been. None of them had ever talked, because when Betty was at that one of those first sessions, they were told, we'll shoot you at dawn. Well, she laughed, and that was not a good idea. And they said, oh, no, we will shoot you at dawn. So nobody ever mentioned it. And they had to be convinced. They had to bring in the Secretary of the Navy to say, you can talk about this now. It's okay. Wow. So I have pictures of her at the National Cryptographic Museum at NSA, where they have one of the bomb machines. And I saw it there a few months ago. And they told me, you know, if we plug this in, it would run. And they were that well built. And so that was the first time she'd seen a completed one. And she, like all the others, would say to me, well, I didn't do that much. I just did my part.
In the chapter titled We Followed Our Stars, you introduce us to two women who stepped out of line at the same time, the sisters Ida and Louise Cook. And I like that their story also intersects with a couple of unexpected things, romance novels and opera. So tell us a little bit about the Cook sisters.
The Cook sisters were quite the characters. Ida and Louise lived in London, and they were both employed as government clerks. And they were spinsters, as the term was used then. So mid-30s, 40s, decided one day they wanted to go to an opera. So they didn't eat lunch for months, saved their money, went to the opera in Covent Garden, and then became opera groupies. They were obnoxious groupies. They would hang out at the stage door and try to meet some of the performers or the symphony conductor. And after a while, they were actually fairly well accepted into that community. And it was, I think, in 1936, they were at an opera in Berlin when the symphony conductor said, would you help one of my friends who wants to go back to London? Can she go back with you? Oh, sure, she can. They didn't realize they were helping someone escape. But once they did, they decided they could continue. And Ida, ever the practical one, just said, well, we were lucky enough to see the problem in terms we could understand. So they would fly to an opera. By now they'd seen them all. And if they were ever questioned, they could tell the whole plot of it anyway. Wearing their dowdy clothes, you know, their twin sweater sets and their long skirts. And they would come back wearing furs and tons of jewelry and excess numbers of watches and have their purses full of more jewels, because you had to show you were self-sufficient to immigrate into Great Britain. And so people were liquidating their life savings into things they could carry. So did they save the entire world? No, but they saved 26 families from certain death by the end of the war. By the time Germany declared war on Great Britain, they had to stop. But by then, they had made quite a difference. They didn't have much money. They went to churches and asked for sponsors and for support. But Ida had another little income-generating business on the side. So between 1935 and 1986, she wrote, I think it's 126 romance novels. And there's one whole series, part of those romance novels, that's about love in the opera world. I have one of these books. I finally found one on eBay. Cost 85 cents when it first came out. Mm-hmm. And it's about a man who falls in love with a painting. So these may not be highbrow books, but they were extremely popular. And Ida, in the 19, 1960s was the second president of the British Romance Novelist Association. And one of the things she liked to say was, well, people come up to me and they say, I don't read your kind of stuff. And she would answer them with, well, I bet you can't write it either. And then she would stalk off.
That's good. I should remember that one.
I called her just a loopy enough to be interesting.
General, two areas I think when I think of female trailblazers are, of course, the military and also athletics. And we've mentioned female athletes who went on to serve in this episode and in our prior episode. So tell us, why do you think that athletes became such important contributors to the war? What characteristics maybe, work well in both settings?
Well, I think one of the things you learn from watching competitive sports is that people don't quit if they have a failure. They don't quit when they trip or fall down, or if they're defeated in one match. They go back, practice again, learn more, get better, and keep going. And especially if we talk about team sports, which the military very much is you're a member of a team and you support each other on that team. And the strongest members of the team pull along those who may not be as strong. It may be at one point in time or another. And so I see all of these connections in that. And in fact, that's the next book in this series I'm going to do is athletes whose careers were disrupted because of World War II and how that changed them and their outlook. And then what they did in terms of mentoring and supporting others. Because there's so much richness in that, and there are so many examples. So unfortunately, that will probably be a very fat book, but I will have fun doing it.
Yeah, there were an awful lot who had careers interrupted. And well, and the other thing, too, there was a long tradition in the Army, especially by World War II, of competitive athletics among various units and all that. And in the interwar period, there were officers whose careers were affected by that, how good their battalion team was or whatever. And so I had this long tradition already. And then another tradition, too, that's already firmly in place by World War II is women in healthcare positions in uniform, and primarily nurses, though not exclusively. There's some physicians, although the bias of the time tended to mitigate against that. But the Army Nurse Corps was pretty well established. And one of my favorite parts of the book, just having really, because I've studied that in some level of depth and gotten an appreciation for how Army nurses are serving, again, all over the planet. And really dealing with something of the worst end of the war on so many levels, and obviously alluding to badly wounded young men and the trauma of care, but also sometimes being in danger, like in the Anzio beachhead, for instance, something like that. So one of the people you write about is Kate Flynn Nolan, who I think is just like a microcosmic example of an Army nurse who, we could never even estimate how many people she helped in the course of the war. What was it that drew you to her?
Well, again, it's that self-effacing view of, I just did my job. She had wanted to be a flight nurse, but when she got to what was then the airfield in Tampa, MacDill Airfield, the program was closed. So that's how she ended up in the field hospital, heavy casualty, training to put up that tent and get ready to go. She'd graduated from nursing school just months before entering the Army. And the perception was, well, the nurses all have it easy. Well, in some places, hospital units did get better food, which was what happened to Charity Adams' unit at first. They thought it must be a nurse unit. So they had chicken. And then later on, it was Spam. And so it was very different. But Kate went all the way from Utah Beach all the way through to the end of the war. She had 5 battle stars. And she talks about seeing bombers. And when they were shelled, because they were supposed to be behind the front lines, but the lines move. And sometimes they were actually being shot at. And they would take their patients, roll them out of the cots onto the ground and lay on top of them until it was safe for them to be moved. And they were not there long. They were only there to be stabilized, and then they were moved to the rear. And it wasn't for many years she knew or what had happened to any of them until she was at a Battle of the Bulge reunion. And one veteran came up to her and wrapped her in a bear hug and said, "I'd know you anywhere." Because they made up songs about her, the little redheaded Irish girl.
And that was something, I mean, for a wounded man in that level of trauma, there, I mean, certainly beyond the professional skill set of being a nurse and how to treat somebody, there was something more to the recovery and recuperation process too. And I think that anecdote you shared about that guy who comes up to Kate all these years later and never forgot her. Mm-hmm. I really do think that there is this kind of subjective kind of healing property from female nurses in this kind of setting. And it seemed like that anecdote was a prime example. I mean, that had probably been on his mind for decades before he saw her again.
And it's also that this is home. When they see an American nurse, that, well, this is someone from home. And I think that was the pull and the attraction there.
Mm. Mary Kay, sorry about that. Let me try that again. Mary Kay, you talk about Elizabeth, Betty McIntosh, and I know she was in the OSS. She talks about how she faced a very tough adjustment period coming back. And I think a lot of these women did because, you know, they lived something that they were doing was so gratifying and they felt like they were making such an amazing difference. And I think for some of them, they came back and they had a period of depression, really, because they didn't have the same opportunities in many ways that they'd had during the war. Can you talk a little bit about that? How did some of these women adjust when they came back? Because you do have a great chapter about later in their lives, you know, what they accomplished. Talk about how that helped them get through that period of readjustment.
Well, most of the books that I had read about World War II and about individuals and their experiences talk about just those war years. But there is the rest of your life. And then it's how you adjust, how you change, how you go on afterwards. And many people did have issues with PTSD or with depression or with adjustment. But the motto of the time was pretty much, let's just go on and put all of that behind us. Now, I'll talk about Betty as McIntosh, but Betty was married 3 times and wrote a number of books, which I had a hard time finding because they're all in different last names. So when Betty comes back from the war, this is after she's been in China, she has participated in some incredibly effective propaganda undertakings. She was part of the OSS Morale Operations Directorate. She'd been a journalist and a newspaper reporter before that, so she was perfectly suited to it. And that was exciting. It was somewhat dangerous. And she thoroughly enjoyed it. She comes back to the U.S., signs out of the OSS. She's married to her second husband, Edward Heppner, who is in the Pentagon. He dies at his desk one day from a heart attack. And she's already been bored. She's working for Glamour magazine. So having done work that is important to your country and then looking at fashion, she was just dismayed by that was what her opportunities or her choices could be. So by the time the CIA is formed, she goes to visit Alan Dulles and says, "Can I please come back?" "Yes." "Okay, but I want to go to Japan," which is what started her in the first place. When she learned Japanese, wanted to go to Japan. He said yes, and she had a full career then with the CIA that she never talked about. And I had met the historians at the CIA who said, "We tried to get it out of her, and she wouldn't tell."
Amazing.
Well, General, you tell a lot of great stories about very compelling women in your book, but obviously you didn't cover the subject entirely. So if your publisher called you up and said, "We need one more chapter," who would that be?
Well, there were some people I could not find enough information about. There were some who it was as though I felt they didn't want me to find them or they didn't want to talk about what they did. Even if they were not living, I couldn't find enough, or I couldn't find family members. So there were some stories I couldn't complete. Certainly, I would like to tell the stories of the photographers and what they did in work. And because the university, Florida State University, has their entire collections for some of these photographers. And I would like to be able to showcase some of that.
Yeah, that would be that would be amazing. And I bet we'd learn a lot from that, too. So, you know, one of the things we've talked about in the previous episode with you, and also this, the importance of stories, of making sure these stories are preserved and kept out there and continue on, that the next generation learn a lot from this and are influenced, whether we really know it or not. And so that this is a priority and important. So I'm going to turn the tables on you. You know, you were talking about how important these stories are from World War II, and for their family members and whatnot, whether they had talked or not. Now, you've got 36 years of experiences to talk about. So I wonder if you've ever thought about sharing your story in a personal memoir, or maybe perhaps whether you've talked with your family and made sure that they are going to know what you were about, what your experiences were.
Well, I think that, yes, people have asked me if I'm going to write that. And my answer is usually, well, I don't think it's that interesting. Which is incorrect based on everything else that we've talked about. But I think that for every generation, you do the very best you can with the opportunities you're given. For most of those women who served in World War II, they were born in 1920, 1921, after women got the vote. So they grew up thinking there was going to be more opportunity for them. And for each succeeding generation, there has been more. And I think where we are now is having volume, that there are more and more women who serve, and in every type of position possible, which wasn't available to them until just a few years ago. Mm-hmm. There were things that I couldn't try to do when I first came into the Army. Can I go to sniper school? No. Okay, can I go to airborne school? Yes. Because when you're 18, 19, you think you can do anything. Mm-hmm. And that you're, 10 feet tall and bulletproof is the expression. But
absolutely.
But you do what you're offered. And some of my experiences are unique because I didn't say no to them. So my civilian time while I was in the reserves was also working for the military. So I spent 5 years in Germany working at the George C. Marshall Center in Garmisch, which teaches democratic principles to the former Soviet republics. So I had some incredible experiences there that I could never have imagined having had otherwise. And I did my reserve duty at the European Command Headquarters in Stuttgart. And that's where I really began to read World War II history. And the more you learn, whether it's your family stories or your unit stories, or you talk about the 7th Regiment, then you understand connections. So many of these people in this book were connected in ways I never could have expected when I started learning about them or writing about them. I had thought they were alone. You know, they had to face so many things alone. And they did, but they were aware there were others. They were aware that they had colleagues in different places. And I think that connection is so important to helping one be able to face adversity and go forward. And that was one of the biggest things I've learned from all of them.
And those connections, like you say, when you came into the Army, you didn't have full opportunities. Here we sit now where a woman in the Army can go to Ranger school, can be an infantry soldier, could be in special operations, whatever it may be. It's possible, let's say 10, 20 years from now, that you would have to register for selective service as a young woman when you turn 18. You know, maybe that would be the case. So, I mean, I would just say I'd encourage you to tell as much about your story as possible for the next generation, because you've seen how it influenced you. You know, you've also turned, you know, your efforts to write another book called The Girls Who Fought Crime. So you've taken it to that level, too. I mean, so in what do you see as your larger mission now in that book, in whatever you're planning to do in the future?
I've just started to talk quite a bit about the new book. And what I have found is interesting to me is when I talk about the girls who stepped out of line, mostly I talk to people who say, my mom was here, my dad did this. Can you help me figure out how I can do research on my parents? And here's where they were. And people give me pictures and stories and books, because what my mom did, what my dad did, that was important too. And they want me to know. What I find when I talk about the new book is people are interested in it to give to my daughter because she wants to be in law enforcement, be a prosecutor, work social work with the police. So I'm finding it's the generations before, and now I'm seeing the generations after, and I'm fascinated with this change.
Yeah. I mean, role models are so important, and examples of what you can look up to and strive toward.
Well, role models and giving back, you know, just because I retired, I wanted to find another way to serve. And if I can write in a way that helps someone, inspires somebody, or if I can talk to those who want to fly. So I've talked to young people about coming into the Air Force, or I've helped people join the military or given them others to mentor them who can help them one more step on their way. And I think it's important to still have that role. You don't walk away from it.
All right, it doesn't change. Yeah, well, I'll tell you, we greatly appreciate your lifetime of service in and out of uniform and continuing now in all these ways. Major General Mary Eder, it is such a pleasure and an honor to have you. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you so much.
John Long, please tell us about today's We Salute You.
Today on our We Salute You feature, we honor the service of Second Lieutenant Reba Z. Whittle, U.S. Army nurse and the only known female POW in the European theater during World War II. Reba Whittle was born in Rock Springs, Texas in August of 1919 and studied at North Texas State College and then went to nursing school in San Antonio. Upon completion, Reba enlisted in the U.S. Army as a nurse. By the end of 1941, of course, the U.S. was at war, and Reba served as a ward nurse at airfields in the western United States. By 1943, however, she was determined to break into the innovative U.S. Army Flight Nurse Program, evacuating wounded soldiers from war zones to hospitals in the rear. The Flight Nurse Program, incidentally, had phenomenally successful survival rate during the war, up to 95% and above. By the beginning of 1944, Reba was posted to Europe with the 813th Medical Air Evacuation Transport Squadron as a second lieutenant. Over the ensuing months, she would log over 500 hours of flight time, especially after June 6, 1944, when Allied forces began pushing through France. On September 27, 1944, Reba climbed aboard a C-47 to head to the front. Flight nurses had little to do on outbound flights since there were no patients yet, and Reba dozed off. Suddenly, a loud jolt awoken, and she saw the left engine on fire. Unbeknownst to the crew, the plane was miles off course and over hostile territory near the German city of Aachen. The pilot was able to make an emergency landing, and all but one of the six passengers got out of the stricken plane alive. Reba was bleeding from a head wound and had suffered a concussion. Soon, German troops surrounded the small group, and they became prisoners of war. The Germans seemed at a loss as to what to do with a female POW. Understandably, Reba was very apprehensive, but eventually was able to suggest to an English-speaking German officer that she be housed at a hospital where there were American wounded and where she could prove useful. You can imagine what a comfort an American nurse would be to the wounded men behind enemy lines. Meanwhile, convoluted negotiations began to arrange a prisoner swap with the Germans, actually a routine process, but never before involving an American woman. It wasn't until January of 1945 that agreement was reached. Reba and more than 100 other wounded Americans were exchanged and made their way back to the United States. She received the Purple Heart and the Air Medal and a promotion to first lieutenant. But by May of 1945, the Army classified her as fit only for light duty due to continued vertigo, headaches, and anxiety attacks. Reba was discharged in January 1946. Meanwhile, she had married a Lieutenant Colonel Stanley Tobiasen. For the next several years, Reba staged a long battle with the Veterans Administration to receive the compensation due to her for combat-related injuries. Incredibly, the government insisted her injuries were not related to battle conditions, despite having been shot down, held prisoner by the enemy, and receiving the Purple Heart. Eventually, the Physical Disability Appeal Board gave her a settlement, but it was far smaller than that to which she was arguably entitled. Reba Tobiasen died of brain cancer in 1981, although whether that was related to the head injuries she sustained in the war could not be known. In 1983, the Pentagon made an effort to honor the heroic Army and Navy nurses who had been held as POWs of the Japanese in the Pacific. Stanley Tobiasen immediately protested. There was one Army nurse left off the list, a prisoner of the German Reich in Europe. That September, the Veterans Administration corrected that slight, and Reba was posthumously awarded the Prisoner of War Medal, the only woman of 94,000 American POWs from the European theater. Reba Whittle Tobiasen, we salute you. Thank you for your service, and thank you for doing your part to save the world.
Yeah, it's ironic because, you know, she's basically anonymous in the European theater, where usually we know that much better in the Pacific theater. The nurses in the Pacific, about 80 or 90 or more, who were captured at Corregidor, are coast-to-coast heroes at that point. I mean, their problem, in a way, is dealing with the adulation, you know, once they come home after the ordeal they've been through. You know, it's really, really interesting that it worked out this way for Reba. Yeah.
Incredible story.
And kind of a microcosm, too, of so many female veterans of World War II not really getting the benefits or having really sometimes fight for the benefits that they had really earned.
Many of them couldn't go back to college either, because those who were serving or had been in classified roles couldn't claim they were veterans, so they couldn't get any veterans benefits as far as education.
Hmm. That's right. It's such a catch-22 in that regard. I mean, well, this has just been absolutely fascinating. Again, we've had Major General Mary Eder on to discuss your book, The Girls Who Stepped Out of Line. Fascinating book. Congratulations on it. And I highly urge everyone to read that book. Just amazing stuff. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Well, you can email our team at podcast@dday.org. If you're enjoying our discussions on World War II and its lasting impact, please subscribe to this podcast, share it with your friends, rate it, and leave us a review. We love hearing from you. Help us share the lessons and legacies of D-Day and World War II. Thanks for joining us, everybody. Take care.
Someone Talked is a production of the National D-Day Memorial Foundation in partnership with Watts Creative Studios. Views expressed are not necessarily those of the foundation. This program was supported by a grant from Virginia Humanities. Virginia Humanities connects people and ideas to explore the human experience and inspire cultural engagement. As the State Humanities Council, Virginia Humanities reaches millions in its estimated annual audience through festivals, grants, fellowships, digital initiatives, teacher institutes, radio programs, podcasts, apprenticeships, and school programs. Headquartered at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville, Virginia Humanities works to serve Virginians in every corner of the Commonwealth. To learn more, visit virginiahumanities.org. Located in Bedford, Virginia, the community that suffered the highest known D-Day loss per capita in the United States, Congress warranted the establishment of the nation's monument to D-Day in this emblematic American home front. Receiving no federal or state funding, the memorial is operated and maintained by a private foundation and donor support. Explore the National D-Day Memorial, plan your visit, and learn more about upcoming events at dday.org. Join the conversation. Email our team at podcast@dday.org. It's no military secret that I love you.
Hey, how about romancing?
If you can keep a secret,
well, can I take you dancing?
If you'll take my heart and keep it, I'm not saying a word. I'm careful whatever I do.
I guess everyone's heard. I wanna give all my love to you. If you gotta talk to someone, don't give any information. It's smart to be a dumb one. Simply change the conversation. Let's talk about love.
That's what I'm thinking of.
It's no secret, no secret. It's no secret that I love you.